Physical strength, sex, vitality, your ability to allure, magnetism, and it is your root base or your monad. It's called the lower dantian. You guys want to go back to that?
Yes.
Okay. Any questions about that while we're waiting for you guys to write that down? Over here, mic runners. We have a mic runner on this side. Hi, Matthew. Good to see you.
Good morning, Lord Toph. Good morning, Galighticus.
I prefer, and let me say this publicly, and I'm glad that you said that. This is something that needs to be, I would prefer if people address me as Sri Master Gano and not Lord Toph. You can acknowledge because, and there's a very clear reason for that. I need to illustrate that. Tahuti Lord Toph is the God form of who I am, but I'm here as Shoe Master Gano Grills. And what happens is when people rearrange that, it causes a different perception. When people come and if they bow or if they do that, they're not bowing to me and they are acknowledging the energy of Tahuti or Lord Toph. You guys get that, right? So I would rather stay in humility and my physical container. Lord Toph is the big version, but he wouldn't fit in this room. He does answer the questions most of the time and puts all of these things together. But I needed to say that, okay? Okay, fantastic, yes.
Question I have for you right now is, how does my name David impact my life stream this lifetime? Dave, my name meaning beloved, and my mother telling me she named me David because he was a man of God's own heart. I wanted to know how that name impacted my lifetime and which God did David have a heart after?
First of all, that would really be more of something that you would want to talk to your mother about. It seems like she's given you that. And in terms of David and the gods that he served, unfortunately, a lot of the people in the Bible were servants of the demigods. And the demigods were the ones that committed the crime of lowering and keeping us here. So it's not like a really big prize. You want to cultivate the energy of what your name means on your own merit and disassociate yourself from the biblical implications of what that means. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, this is more of a personal question that has nothing to do with any of this. That would be something that we have to deal with another time. Okay?
Yes.
Does everyone have that?
Yes.
You have a question over here on the left? Okay, we're gonna get you the microphone.
Hello.
Hi, what's your name and where are you from?
My name is Mercedes, I'm from Los Angeles.
Okay, thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me. I'd like to know, what does it mean if, during the video, you feel extremely choked up, you feel like you're going to burst into tears, but you control that, and you don't allow yourself to cry? What does that mean?
What does it mean? It means that you have a feeling of allowing yourself to have the energy flow freely. You know, control is not always, it's an interesting word, isn't it? When I see, you know, Brandon, stand up, Brandon. Brandon is one of my students, and we had an experience. We were in Namaste Bookstore, and we were talking about the god Balder. And before I knew it, he was crying. You know, it wasn't the ugly cry or anything, and I said, Brandon, are you crying? He's like, yes. Jason, where's Jason at? Jason, stand up, Jason. Jason, he'll pull out a tear on you in a minute. Right? Jason also has the ability to allow the energy of what needs to be expressed to freely flow. So I would offer this to all of you. Thank you, Jason. I would offer this to all of you in the future and from this day on. Don't block that. Don't block the process of allowing the tears which occur because it's a validation of things. Tears are a benefit to us. And when we, you know, well, I'm not gonna cry because, you know, I'm from Brooklyn, my Leo is in, you know, I'm gonna cry right now. We're not doing ourselves a service when we constrict the natural flow of things. I'm gonna say this, and I'm not gonna give you the number, but I was telling Chain of Command yesterday, I was complaining about how much this seminar cost me to give. And I was in PTSD for like an hour when I looked at the bill, because I said, wow. And they texted me this morning and said, oh, by the way, if you don't, finish the payment, you know, it's going to threaten the rest of your weekend. And they took half. And it was some people's yearly salary. It was a lot. So I wrestled with that, and I said, I got it together, and I said, you know, money, when people save it and they hoard it like things, it doesn't allow other monies to come in. So when you hoard your emotions by controlling the flow of what is trying to emerge from you, what happens is the energy of that becomes a ping pong within you. And the energy of that will go directly to where you have other stored up disturbances. And this is how people develop cancer. Because it will stay there and it will trap there and it will become a pocket, and then next thing you know, it's a cyst or it's a tumor, right? These are unresolved issues a lot of times emotionally that we suppress, depress, and crying and even weeping is a beautiful utility that we all can benefit from. So, again, the next time you feel the need or you feel that coming, it doesn't matter if you're on a train, plane, or automobile. Let it flow. And don't be embarrassed. Don't be ashamed to let this come through you. And that's one of the reasons why I respect Brandon and Jason so much, because, again, these are men, and they don't have a problem showing that. All right? Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay, fantastic. Does everybody have this? Sheila, I'll answer this question because we have to move on, but good to see you, beloved.
I am so grateful.
Oh, we're going to get you the mic. I'm sorry about that. Sheila's another one of my beloved students. It's so good to see you. Can you stand up and let everybody look upon me? Go ahead. Don't be ashamed. I'm going to get you, Sheila.
I'm so grateful because a question that I had, you are answering, because I'm always crying. I'm at my altar and tears just flow. And I was wondering, Are the guys just getting irritated with me for being a big crybaby? And I was just speaking with a lady today about, you know, tears and crying and things like that. But, and then Jason, yesterday, we hugged. He said, your heart chakra. And he just really, really picked that up. And I thank you for that. My question was answered.
Fantastic. And, right? You know, the benefit of that, and you know, I'm sorry that you had to be encumbered with that all of this time, because, you know, that emotion, the highest degree of emotion is not always laughter and joy. Sometimes it's tears of joy or tears of clarity. And this is something that does get the attention of higher beings that are more inclined to listen to you. When you have the ability to be truthful, you can't lie and deceive when you're crying. Now I'm talking about crocodile tears. When tears are coming from your heart chakra, it is something that inclines higher beings to assist you better. So you will not be a pestilence to them, and they appreciate that. Okay? And thank you for that, Jason. All right. So the next is called the Middle Dantian. And the Middle Dantian is located, obviously, where your heart space is, so the Anahata region. And it controls emotion, devotion, depth, morality, and virtue. People say it with your chest. That's what they are talking about. Have some depth, devotion, and validation, morality and virtue with what it is that you are espousing. I also would advocate that everyone take really good notes, because sometimes people have a propensity to bring questions from other seminars that have passed. This is an opportunity to get all of the questions out that you may have about this seminar, because when we get to the next seminar, I will not entertain it, okay? So don't hold yourself back. And take really, really good notes if there's something that sparks you. And this is the mind, belief, ideals, intelligence, philosophy, evolution, enlightenment, enrichment, and emancipations. Relationships that are formed from this level are beyond the need for physical gratification, sex, and exterior presentations. They are often the highest forms of, by the way, guys, do you guys want these notes that I'm reading right now? Okay, who is going to volunteer to write down them? This is slide 7 of the Love Seminar. So you guys can just listen to what I'm saying and you don't have to scramble to write it down, because for people who have transacted, you guys will get, this will be your first slide, okay? So, relationships that are formed from this level are beyond the need for physical gratification, sex, exterior presentations. They are often the highest forms of love because they transcend time and space. These are the relationships that span for many lifetimes. They are beyond gender, race, and ethnicity. These are what love songs aspire to be. They are what romance novels strive for. They go far beyond the altruistic, and they are the epitome of devotion, dedication, and loyalty. All dynasties and kingdoms thrive when the citizens elucidate this level of love that is controlled by the upper Dantian. Few humans oscillate here. Actually, souls bring themselves into a diminished capacity to demonstrate their willingness to practice and hopefully master this kind of love. I'm going to show you guys some real pictures of relationships of people who demonstrate what upper Dantian love is about. And unfortunately, a lot of times it is ridiculed publicly. It's laughed at because people don't understand why a 7-foot woman would be with a man that is 3 foot tall, but they have an understanding that goes beyond what is socially accepted. And this also demonstrates the upper Dantian love. So I will let you guys know when we get to that slide so you can take it in. And hopefully all of you guys will be mature enough to respect it whenever you see it. I'm sure you guys actually have. When you see an old 97-year-old woman with, you know, a young Nigerian man, this is what love can produce. It multiplies. And this is an example of what occurs when you have an open and healthy heart chakra. The presence of love is able to multiply things in your life, in your consciousness. It is a template from which a divine, healthy consciousness is built upon. Why is the creation of the human heart so sacred? The templates of the multidimensional complex are within. The gods that designed it, its formation, placed it within its arrangement, and it ensures that proper evolution can emerge from the growth of the corresponding templates. What does that mean? What it means in short is that you will not evolve into higher forms of what you could be if you do not have a healthy, evolved heart chakra. Is everyone clear about that? Does anyone have any questions about that? Eldred, how are you, sir? It's good to see you.
Good to see you, too.
Hi, Lucy.
Greetings.
Glad you guys made it.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Is it a thing if your heart chakra is too open? Is that possible?
That's a great question. I would say there's a duality to that. The dichotomy that associates itself with it is that in certain situations, there are some people that have a perceived way to open heart chakra and they lend it to where it not ought be. You want to have discernment in terms of, you know, someone has a healthy estate financially. You don't want to squander that to people who will be attracted to you and want to misuse your serendipity. Does that make sense? So if you have a heart chakra that, again, is hyper open, you usually end up becoming a saint or a sage, someone like Padre Pio or Mother Mary, or someone who is inclined to be totally exhausted in the service of humanity. Officer Stephanie, one of my students, also shared a post on Facebook the other day that was something that Mahatma Gandhi said. And he said the best way, if I remember correctly, the best way to find yourself is losing yourself in the service of others. And then I posted, literally. So that's probably one of the most useful utilities that you can have, because having an open heart chakra that is really well established will guide you to where, will, or to what will speed up your evolution. Okay? Oh, I had made a promise. I posted this on Facebook the other day. It's a $1,000 question. Anyone who can get the answer. But I have to whisper the answer in someone's ear. I need one of my students come up real quick so I can whisper it in your ear just to validate.
I'm cutting the mic off, man. Okay, so We're back.
Gone? Thank you. Jason has the answer for validation. And the question is, the Ajna is the first eye, or the ethereal light. And the Anahata is the sacred light, which is where your sacred space is. The Mid-Dantian, as we said before, is where your solar plexus houses the energy of the sun. That's why it's called your solar plexus, and it is what gives you the energy that you use in day-to-day life. The question, the $1,000 question, we'll give a couple. Do you guys want to participate in that?
Yes.
You do?
Yes.
Oh, shit. So I'm not wasting your time, am I?
No.
Okay. So, the question is, the sacred light, the Anahata region, why is that so powerful? Simple question. You're the first one that I saw with your hand up, so I'm going to give you an opportunity. Go ahead. Okay, say that again into the mic.
Because that's where all thoughts are received.
By the way, with every answer that gets shot down, it makes it easier for you guys, doesn't it? So I'm gonna give three more people the opportunity, and then we're gonna put it back into my pocket so I can pay the hotel a small piece of what I owe them. Anthony Upscales Photos. How are you, sir? Good to see you again, sir. Another one of my students. It's
a pleasure to see you as well.
Yes, sir.
Ashe. I would say that the reason why that is the most important one is because this is where your higher self descends into your body first.
That was cute. I like that. Next. Hey, how you doing, young man? Michael, right? Is it? Okay. And welcome to the studentship program. It's good to see you again. Sure. We'll give you a round of
applause. I'm sorry.
We'll give you the opportunity.
Okay. I think the sacred light or the heart chakra acts as a bridge between the solar plexus and your crown chakra.
Cute, man. That's really cute. I like that. We're going to give someone way over there. The lady with the glasses, you haven't had an opportunity yet. What's your name and where are you from?
Brooklyn.
Brooklyn? What's your name?
I think it's because...
No, what's your name?
Oh,
got
sorry.
Your name, like, what's your name?
Tina Braxton.
Tina?
Braxton.
Okay, nice to meet you, Tina.
Likewise. That's where your emotions house. Your emotions are housed in the heart chakra. And if you look, go back and read mummification, that's the only organ that was left in the body.
You definitely got the cute going. I like it. I like that a lot. You know, so we already had four, but I'll let one more person take a crack at it. Is that Kat over there? All the way over here in the front? Yeah, why not? Let's give you a shot, young lady.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
And what's your name and where are you from?
Hi, my name is Ebony. I'm from Brooklyn.
Okay.
Thank I'm you. Just going to take a crack at it, but I think...
Go for it.
Because that's where we feel our emotions first, and it's like the core, like the brain to our bodies in a way, on a higher level.
Right. I like that. That's not
like bad. The gut.
Yeah. This is number five. And you guys think I won't give Officer Jeffrey an opportunity? I will. Okay, Jeff, you're going to get the last crack.
All right.
All right. Hold on a second. Let me get you the mic. See, I don't discriminate. How many seminars have you been to, Jeff?
I think it's divisible of three.
About 15, 20 seminars? You've been to quite a few.
Yes, I've been with you for many lifetimes. Yeah. I don't know.
Sure. You know, Jeff might have the answer. Go ahead.
I want to say it is the gateway to the creators. It's a portal to the creator.
That's definitely cute. But Jason, that's not the answer, is it, Jason? No, that's better. See, a lot of people say, well, if I go to the creator, that's the highest you can go in the past. Just because it was your birthday, Angel Rose, Let's give you a shot. Let's see what you got for us. And you're gonna have the very last opportunity, guys, because we have to move on.
All right, but then can I use a lifeline and I'll share it with somebody? Can I use a lifeline?
Can you do that? No, this is not that show. Sorry. Are you gonna call Brother Panic? Go ahead, Liz, whisper in her ear. See if Liz knows the answer. Five.
So I want to say it's
four.
Because it's part of your soul. That's where your soul is, I guess. That's where your soul is, and you can use that light to create manifestation.
C-U-T-E. That was really cute. Thank you. Okay, guys. So I'll let that stay there. Maybe we'll generate another $1,000 question.
Why not?
But that's not the answer. And what is the answer? Hello, Julia. You want to know the answer?
Yes.
But if I give you the answer,
you're gonna say yes, I do.
Okay. Well. The reason that the Anahata region of the sacred space is so powerful, it is the middle Dantian, and this is where they are the ones that have given us the technology of having the heart chakra as the major organ in our bodies that gives us the energy to live our lives. How many of you knew that? None of you. Stop it. Stop it.
How's it going, Saturday? You just didn't call on me.
Yes. Sorry?
If I said the covenant that we make between ourselves and the people that created us or our higher self,
would that have been the answer?
No, close. What I'm saying,
it would have been on the distant side of the parkway, about 30 miles down. If that makes sense. Chanel Brown got me saying that. It's your fault, Chanel. Let's try Emil Burgess. Okay. So, here, there are many kinds of light in the grand form of divine creation. Humanity knows only two. How many kinds of lights exist? I'm gonna give you the list. Possessed by no other in their creation. Isn't that interesting? Okay. When higher beings wished to experience the lower worlds, they had to
You want to do it the hard way, huh?